to send a letter of appeal. Still didn't do anything. Finally, on May the 12th, 2014, they filed this action. Then it had to be a case management conference, and here we are now at that point. We've got a motion to compel, and still it takes you forever to do anything. You file an answer finally, and that answer doesn't at all respond to what the district court suggested. And then you file a cross motion for summary judgment. At that point, the district court's pretty mad. We'd say it differently in Idaho, but mad. And now you're saying, okay, I submitted an affidavit before. I'm now submitting another affidavit. I'm not going to do it the way you told me to do it. I'm not going to give you the report and take it down face by face and tell me what the basis is about what you do. I'm just going to give you whatever the heck I want to give you. We'd say that a little bit different, I know. And you're going to have to deal with it. Is that the way the Department of Defense always responds? I mean, to me, if I had to give deference to the district court and their decision, I'd give a lot of deference here. So do I take that into account?
No, Your Honor.
No, I have to just throw it out and say you can act whatever you want in a FOIA request. Be as ornery as you want, as disgusting as you want, and I still have to give you the right to argue the exemption on four.
Well, Your Honor, I mean, generally, in terms of the procedure or the process that the agency follows, there generally isn't a claim based on that. District Court did ultimately reach the merits, and, you know, when we submitted both a redacted and an unredacted version of the plan for the court's in-camera review, along with the declaration, and as it turns out, it was not exactly what the district court wanted, but we thought we were being helpful, and we apologize that it turned out it wasn't what the district court wanted.
You didn't try.
Well,
you just said what you wanted.
Well,
you said a redacted to him and an unredacted, or redacted to the other side and an unredacted to him. And he had to guess. Now he's got to go through. And based on this affidavit, which really doesn't pertain to what you said, is generally there. So I have to look through the affidavit to find out what the devil you're really saying. You don't explain it.
I think with all due respect, I mean, we thought we were being helpful. We certainly did not intend to make it difficult for the district court or for this court. But ultimately, the district court did reach the merits, and he did not decide on the basis of the fact that we didn't comply with his request. He ultimately did reach the merits, and it's the merits of his decision that is the basis for our appeal here.
Okay. I hear your answer.
And I would like to emphasize, you know, the types of information here. You know, if the entirety of the report were disclosed, competitors would learn the types of items and services that Sikorsky subcontracts for, who it obtains them from, how much it pays. And it shouldn't be too hard to understand that a company really wouldn't want that information to be disclosed to its competitors. You know, information about those sorts of details about its supply chain are proprietary and the sorts of things that companies do closely guard. The district court also, incorrectly held that none of the information that we've redacted with respect to the business contact information or the signatures of some of the employees was protected by Exemption 6. This court expressly recognized a non-trivial privacy interest in an employee's email address in Electronic Frontier Foundation. And importantly, plaintiff has never asserted a public interest in disclosure of any of this information. And indeed, there's no conceivable public interest here in the redacted signatures or email addresses.
So at that point, we're just measuring, we're just weighing. There isn't really a heavy privacy interest, but it certainly outweighs the disclosure.
That's correct. There is at least a minimal privacy interest here, and there's absolutely no public interest here. I would emphasize that the only relevant public interest when the court balances is shedding light on the agency's performance of its statutory duties or otherwise.
use the information against Sikorsky. Maybe it will, maybe it won't. So the best the declarant can say is it could. And what the district court said was, could's not enough. That was the only basis for rejecting the exemption for. And I submit that's simply not the law, nor should it be the law, that you have to show, in fact, harm, competitive harm, will happen. Opposing counsel also says we have to show that there's actual competition. We agree, we do have to show that. But 2 points about that. The first is this wasn't raised below by the plaintiff, and so they've waived it. And the second point is our declarations make it very clear that, in fact, we are in competition with the list of companies that we name and that we're in competition for government contracts, which is what this is all about. So that is the second element of establishing exemption for. You've got to show actual competition, and you've got to show it could harm you. And we respectfully submit that our declarations establish both of those things here. And therefore, the district court simply erred in rejecting exemption for. On exemption six, I think, Judge Smith, you had it just right. Not an overwhelming privacy interest in the email addresses, the phone numbers, and the signatures, but no public interest whatsoever in those being turned over to the plaintiff. They don't show anything, not anything about how the government operates, how it makes
says, look, we're in competition for government contracts. We compete with Bell Helicopters. We compete with these other firms. And if you have pricing information, you have information how we intend to cost, what we're going to fund in-house, what we're going to send to outside suppliers, then you now have information about how we're going to structure our deal. That may give you a competitive advantage. How could they possibly prove that you'll use that?
Your Honor, in your example, you mentioned pricing information. I don't believe that that's an issue here. I do not believe there's any pricing information in the heavily redacted document I've seen. To be honest, oftentimes I can't tell what has been redacted by the company.
But there are ways in which they've indicated how they determine whether they're going to do something in-house, how they're going to send something out. They've got information in there about how they use their small business subcontractors. And if that's useful, and they said that it is useful, then how can they possibly prove that somebody will use that information?
Your Honor,
does it always have to be conditional? It doesn't always have to say, if Bell Helicopter uses this information, it will be useful to them. But it's still got to be conditional.
But you've got to provide the trial court